During our last class, yesterday, during the end of our class, we talked about flow over a doublet. And yesterday we said that how flow over a doublet behaves like, and we found out that it behaves like circular loops, and doublet is something which has some kind of sense or direction. Today we are going to use a combination of uniform flow with doublet flow, and actually this is something which has a physical significance, and we would be actually studying non-lifting flow. When I say non-lifting flow, then I mean that there is no lift being produced. Lift is known as the force, which is for such a simple case I can say lift is the force which would be perpendicular to the direction of uniform flow. It's a simple way to say lift in this particular case. Lift is a flow which is perpendicular to the direction of the uniform flow, and drag, sorry, lift is the force, and drag is the force which is in the direction of uniform flow. So what we are going to study today is non-lifting flow over a circular cylinder. To study this kind of non-lifting flow over a circular cylinder, meaning by what we are going to study is that, let's say you have a circular cylinder, and I want to study that how, when there is a flow happening over it, what happens. So in 2D, the circular cylinder would look like a circle. Okay, now to study that physical phenomena using mathematical tools available to us to analyze them, what we are going to use, we are going to use two elementary flows. One is uniform flow, the other is doublet flow. These flows are completely ideal shape of flows. In reality, we don't see something like that. Maybe something close to uniform flow we can observe, but something like a doublet flow, it is very difficult to make a real doublet flow. But using these two ideal cases, using these two solutions, adding them, we can get something which is close to reality. So I would take the stream function of uniform flow. Already I know about it, psi equals to V infinity r sine theta. Here it is. Then I would take stream function of doublet flow. In our last class we also talked about that, and using that I would get the stream function, combined stream function. Now this shape which you are seeing here, this circular shape and everything, this is not known to me at this stage, although I have drawn it, but at this stage this is not known to me. So it's not like I knew about it from before and then I made this kind of shape and then afterwards I'm doing analysis. It's not like that. I only knew stream function of uniform flow, stream function of doublet flow, and that's from where I would start. Now let us see how it would look like. My combined stream function would be addition of these two stream function, okay, which is this here given to me, which is V infinity r sine theta minus kappa by 2 pi sine theta by r. I can rearrange it in such a way that I can write it to be equal to V infinity r sine theta. I would take this common, and 1 minus r square, capital R square, divided by small r square. I can do that. Where this capital R is equal to kappa divided by 2 pi v infinity. That's what this is, capital R. Okay. Small r, like we know in doublet case, small r, or this r which you are seeing in uniform flow case, this is nothing but any point P in which we are interested, and its distance from center. So for example, if there is this point P, then small r, here is its location. That's what this is. Now, since we know our stream function, it is very easy to find now my radial velocity, and I can very easily find my tangential velocity. So my radial velocity is Vr, I can easily find it. My tangential velocity would be V theta, and I can find it. The only thing I need to do is Vr would be equal to 1 by r del psi by del theta. Yes. किस जगह पे बात कर रहे हैं आप, जहाँ मैंने साई लिखा है? अच्छा अच्छा अच्छा, देख लो बेटा एक बार फिर से देख लो। अच्छा, तो आप ये कह रहे हैं कि ये होना चाहिए V infinity r sin theta 1 minus r by r,
r by r square,
r by r square,
r square.
Okay, just give me a second. Okay, so it's V infinity जैसे, इसको भी चेक करके दिखाइए फिर मेरे लिए। Vr जो मैं निकालूंगा, I have written it like this, 1 by r V infinity r cos theta 1 minus r by r. Let's check Vr मेरा सही आ रहा है या नहीं। यही मुझे करना चाहिए, या तो मैं आर स्क्वायर इसके बराबर लूंगा तब तो ये बात सही हो जाएगी, या सिंपली हाँ ये इस तरीके से करके लूंगा तब ये सही हो जाएगा, तब सेंस बनता है, तब ये एक जैसे मैं ले सकता हूँ इनको। Now it makes sense. ठीक है, अब ये सही है। जाहिर है ये r इस r को टेक केयर कर लेगा, तो यहाँ अगर मुझे स्क्वायर देना है तो कैपा बाई 2 पाई v इन्फिनिटी स्क्वायर रूट में देना होगा। ठीक है, ओके, थैंक्स। इफ दैट्स द केस देन वी आर फिर इस तरीके से मैं लिख सकता हूँ और लेट अस सी वी थीटा आल्सो यू के बराबर होता है डेल साई बाई डेल आर के. इसका मतलब है कि जो मेरा ऊपर साई है इसको विद रिस्पेक्ट टू आर अगर मैं डिफ्रेंशिएट करता हूँ तो दिस शुड गिव मी वी इन्फिनिटी आर साइन थीटा टू आर स्क्वायर बाई आर क्यूब प्लस वन माइनस आर स्क्वायर बाई आर स्क्वायर और ये हो जाएगा वी इन्फिनिटी साइन थीटा. जस्ट चेक इट अगेन टू सी इफ दिस इज ओके और नॉट. And if that's the case, then I can take V infinity sine theta outside and 1 plus capital R square by small r square V infinity sine theta. I can do that. I can do that. Okay. So I have my Vr with me. Let's say this is equation 1 and I have my V theta with me. This is equation 2. Now to see what kind of shape this would make, I need to find stagnation points. After finding coordinates of the stagnation point, I would put that back into my stream function and I would find a streamline which would be known as stagnation streamline. So to do that, for locating stagnation points, we will put Vr equal to 0 and V theta equal to 0, meaning by 1 minus r square by r square, V infinity cos theta would be 0. And 1 plus r square by r square V infinity sine theta would be 0. I would have to do that. Now, after simultaneously solving both the equations for r and theta, we can find two stagnation points. If I would solve these equations, I would find two stagnation points. One of those stagnation points would be r, 0. The second one would be r, pi. Okay? R, 0, R, pi. These are the two stagnation points. And this is something which if you would come back, this is something R, 0, it is shown by point A. R, pi is shown by point B. So right now, I know nothing but I know about two points. I don't know the shape at this particular time. The only thing I know are two stagnation points. A and B, one of them is r, 0. R, 0 is on the right hand side of and on the x axis, positive x axis. R, pi is on the negative x axis, which is shown by point B. Now, by putting coordinates of A and B in psi, we can find psi equals to 0. This 0 means it's, I have taken it to be the stagnation streamline. So I can write psi and that would be V infinity r sine theta. I know about this psi, 1 minus r square by r square equal to 0. Now since theta equal to pi and theta equal to 0 satisfies the above equation. Theta equal to pi and theta equal to 0, since that satisfies this above equation 3, then I can say that the entire horizontal axis extending towards the right side of point A and left side of point B, the entire x-axis, horizontal axis, okay, upstream of B and downstream of A is part of the stagnation streamline. That's what this is. Okay, that's what this means. Capital R here, it denotes the radius of my stagnation streamline. My stagnation streamline would be a straight line along the x-axis, then a circle, and then another straight line on the x-axis. Capital R denotes the radius of that circle, stagnation streamline. Small r is any point r, this is variable. Small r is the distance of any point of interest to me in the flow field. Now there are few things which I can get from the analysis which I have done up till now. Now let's look at that. Point number one. Now before I go to point number one, let us look at this figure again. This flow over a cylinder figure again. I have drawn my x-axis and y-axis here. Okay. If you would observe this figure, you would find out that my flow is completely symmetrical about my x-axis and my y-axis. Meaning by, if you would look at the streamlines, you would see that the top and the bottom of x-axis looks exactly the same, and the right and left of y-axis looks exactly the same. It means that my flow is completely symmetrical about my x and y axis. And this is point one. That entire flow field is symmetrical about both the horizontal and the vertical axis. And if my velocity, meaning by if my streamline are symmetrical, it means the velocity field is also symmetrical. If velocity field is symmetrical, then I know about it that the flow is caused by some kind of force. Here, that force is the pressure force. So if my velocity field is symmetrical, then it means that my pressure field is also symmetrical. So my pressure distribution is also symmetrical about my x-axis and my y-axis. And if that's the case, if for this cylinder, flow is happening in such a way that it is completely symmetrical on top and bottom, on right and left. If the pressure distribution is completely symmetrical, pressure from top acting on it is same as pressure from bottom acting on it. It means there is no net upward or downward force. If the pressure from right side and pressure from left side is completely symmetrical on this cylinder, then it would mean that there is no sideways movement. There is no net resultant sideways force. So that's what they have written here, that because of this pressure distribution which is completely symmetrical, there is no net lift and no drag. Now, in reality, if let's say this is a cylinder and I am blowing on it, something like this. Okay, it is easy to understand that maybe there is no upward or downward force acting on it. But it is very difficult to digest that in reality, if I am blowing on it, then I won't feel any force on my finger. There would always be some kind of force acting in the direction of flow. So when this analysis was done before, this kind of mathematical analysis, and people looked at the observation, they found that there is a paradox between them. Okay, there is no lift, easy to understand, but there is no drag, meaning by there is no force acting in the direction of flow, This makes no sense. So this paradox between the theoretical and the actual observation, this was first observed by this scientist Jean-Laurent d'Alembert, and this was done in 1700s, and that is why this thing is known as d'Alembert's paradox, that what you are getting from your mathematical analysis is different from what you are observing in reality. Now, during 18th and 19th centuries, no one could explain it, that why the analysis which we are getting is completely different from the physical observation which we had. But afterwards, when the physical science, it advanced a little bit, and people started to observe and analyze that there are viscous effects also which are present. There is another thing known as viscous effect which is present. So after knowing that there are viscous effects present, it was possible to analyze these kind of problem and understand that, okay, in your mathematical analysis which you took, you never considered the effect of viscous effect, and that is why you are getting this difference between your mathematical analysis and your physical observation. So now we know that drag is due to viscous effect, which generate frictional shear stresses at the surface of the body. This causes the flow to separate from the surface. This causes the flow to separate from the surface on the back of the body, thus creating a wake and destroying the symmetry of the flow about the vertical axis. So this is what happens in reality, that let's say if you have a cylinder and there is flow in reality happening on it, then in reality it is possible that a streamline on top and bottom are same. But the streamlines on the left hand side and right hand side won't be the same, because there would be viscous effects due to which there is going to be flow separation. Here it is possible that on the upstream side the streamline is completely coming very close to the surface, but it won't follow the surface afterwards. There would be some kind of flow separation, and this flow separation happens because of the viscous effects present. So this is something which is already known to us. Now at this point, if you can make a note somewhere, there is a little bit more of analysis which is done to find what kind of forces are acting on this cylinder, but it requires us to have the knowledge of Bernoulli's equation. But Bernoulli's equation is something which I have not covered with you yet. So generally what I do, I leave this part, and once we would go to unit 3 and I would cover Bernoulli's equation, then I would come back here and I would cover that part. So please make a note, wherever you are writing your notes, please jot it down, that after covering Bernoulli's equation, I need to come back here and do this study. And basically, just you need to write that what actually I am going to do is pressure distribution. After unit 3, Bernoulli's equation. So we would come back to it afterwards. Now, can we, you know, in this kind of flow up till now, we have not considered a case, although we have considered a case of flow over a cylinder such that there is no lifting flow, but we were interested, like I told, into how lifts are created over an air wing or aerofoil, something like that. So what to do for that and how we can do that. And if you would remember in the very start, I said that in your flow, if there is non-zero circulation, then you would see that some kind of lift would be generated. Whenever there is a non-zero circulation, then there is a lift will be generated. All of the cases which we have done up till now, if you would try to find circulation, okay, you just need to take a closed surface sometime, and that closed curve is not a surface, closed curve. That closed curve again is completely up to you. If you want to find circulation using V dot ds, you need to take a closed curve. If you want to find circulation using V cross, you know, through vorticity, if you want to find circulation, then you need to take an area. It is completely up to you. You can, depending on your problem, you can take a circular curve or area surface, or you can take a rectangular or any shape depending on your problem. Up till now, whatever cases we have covered, if you find circulation for all of these cases, your circulation would come out to be zero. Next, we would look at a flow, again an ideal flow, a basic elementary flow, a building block, which would give you a finite circulation, non-zero circulation. We would look at that, and that is something which we would do in our next class, and that would be vortex flow. Vortex flow. In the source flow or the sink flow, we said that source or sink flow is such kind of flow that we have radial velocity vectors coming out from a single point, from a center. This vortex flow is a flow in which there is no radial flow, but the complete flow is tangential in nature. The complete flow is tangential in nature. So for example, in your source or sink flow, your streamlines were radial lines and your V theta was zero. In your vortex flow, VR would be zero and you would have your streamline in the form of circles. So that is going to be your vortex flow, and this is something which we would cover in our next class. I would like you to go back to your book, read again, and the equations which I have written today, please recheck them if there is any mistake, and let me know tomorrow. Okay, that would be pretty much it for today's class. If you have any questions or queries, then let me know. By the way, you can look at your deadline for the assignment, and please try to finish it on time and submit it on time. Okay, thanks a lot.